day out, making sure that, again, our kids and our families are getting what they need. And thank you. From the bottom of my heart, from my colleagues in the General Assembly, I know many of you probably don't hear that on a regular enough basis. So I just wanted to start off by saying that. So we're gathered here today because we know that, frankly, you all need help. And that's what we're going to try to do. We are going to try to get legislation through, either standalone or as part of our relief package that we're working on in the General Assembly, to make sure that we can do what we can to help you. And so you're going to hear today from a number of individuals who, you know, are day in, day out, making sure that their kids and their families have what they need. You're going to hear from some parents who are navigating our difficult system. And you're going to hear what the impact of support, and frankly, if you don't get support, what that's going to look like. So I wanted to just start off by recognizing a couple of elected officials who are with us or who have been real champions through this whole year. So first and foremost, I wanna recognize my friend, Senator Nancy King, who's gonna speak shortly and is graciously gonna be our Senate sponsor for the work that we're doing. Delegate Ariana Kelly, I'm not sure if she was able to join us. I hope she will as well. Also from Montgomery County, who has just been a huge champion on childcare issues and has been a great friend and help on the work that we've been doing recently. I also wanted to recognize Delegate Eric Ebersol from Baltimore and Howard County, who chairs the subcommittee in the House on early learning and has also been a great champion and partner in this work. And then two other legislators who I know could not join us today, but have been with us every step of the way. Senator Craig Zucker from Montgomery County, who chairs the Senate Budget Committee and has been a great partner, and Delegate Ben Barnes from Prince George's County, who chairs the House Committee, who has been a great partner in our on the Appropriations Committee this year. So I wanted to make sure we recognize them. And then I wanted to recognize the sponsoring organizations who, without them, frankly, this rally would not have been possible. And many of them, many of the staff are working furiously behind the scenes to help us manage the Zoom. And the reason we had over 600 people register and take part in the advocacy around this is because of their work. So first I wanna recognize Chris Push from the Maryland Childcare Association, and then Christina Lopez from the Maryland Association for the Education of Young Children. I wanted to recognize Laura Wildreyer from the Maryland Family Network and really her whole team, Clinton McSherry, Doug Lant, Beth Morrow, who have just done incredible work in helping us get all this set up. Ruby Daniels from the Maryland State Family Child Care Association, Sarah Mickey, who's with Marylanders Against Poverty and the Baltimore Jewish Council, Sharon Friedman and her whole team from Montgomery Moving Forward, Ashley Bagwell, Mary Bennett, and Farah Cantor. And last but not least, SEIU 500, I want to recognize Beth Myers, and I think I saw Travis Simon on as well, although I know I don't think he can stay with us the whole time. But again, without these sponsoring organizations, this would not have been possible. And they've been with us, frankly, every step of the way since last spring in, you know, advocating for more resources, for better policy, for, you know, improved PPE. You are all very well represented in Annapolis by these organizations. And so I wanted to make sure you knew that. So now I want to just turn it over to Senator Nancy King, who, again, is my good friend and is our partner in the Senate on this work, to just say a couple of words.
Thank you, Jared, and thank you for all of you who have joined onto this call today. Kind of fun just sitting here and looking at all the people that I have worked with on these issues for so very many years. Sharon Friedman and I were in PTA together many years ago, so we've come a long way working on child care issues. We've been working on COVID relief issues for the last several months and how we are going to recover. And when the bill came out, the Senate bill came out, there's nothing in there for childcare. So Jared and I have had our heads together and have done this legislation to try and get the childcare in there, because if we don't have good childcare for our kids, we are not going to recover from this. Our businesses aren't going to recover and people can't get back to work. So it's been a pleasure for me to work with him. We have some very bright shining stars over there in the House with Ariana Kelly and Jared. And it's been fun for me to work with them. So we will be continuing. We'll do whatever we can to get some relief for the childcare people, and look forward to working with all of you.
Thanks, Senator King. And Senator King's exactly right. We're going to do everything we can to get this into the relief package that we're working on. And we know, frankly, even the amount that's in here may not be enough. And we want you to know that this is the start. We stand with you. We know we need more investments from top to bottom in childcare. We'd love to be talking about expanding access as well. And hopefully when COVID is a thing of the past, we can refocus our efforts on that as well. So now I want to turn it over to and introduce Cheryl Oldham, who's at the Center for Education and Workforce at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Foundation. And Cheryl and her team put out a really incredible report recently called Piecing Together Solutions, which really focuses on just the incredible role that you all play in growing our economy and in allowing, frankly, the rest of the community to get back to work. So Cheryl, thanks for being here, and I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Good afternoon, everyone. As Delegate Solomon said, my name is Cheryl Oldham, and I oversee the Center for Education and Workforce at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Foundation. And I want to thank you, Delegate, for reaching out and for inviting my perspective here today. I'm honored, certainly, to be here with all of you. I want to say at the start, the Chamber Foundation doesn't endorse legislation. So I think my contribution today is really to share a bit, as Delegate Solomon said, about this report and why this issue is so critical to the reopening of the economy and getting all Americans back to work, and to provide some data points from the recent surveys we conducted that ground our perspective and really support the assertion that I just made. At the Chamber Foundation, we see childcare as a two-generation workforce issue, essential to support the workforce of today and also vital to developing our workforce of tomorrow. Childcare enables more than 14 million parents with young children to participate in our workforce. And now, as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, families are experiencing additional challenges, and finding childcare can be nearly impossible. I think, you know, for any working parents listening out there, myself included, this is not news to you. In a series of surveys we conducted last year from June through November, we found a few things that I wanted to share with you. I think some stark data points. 2/3 of working parents have changed their childcare arrangement due to the pandemic. And nearly a year in, the majority have yet to find a permanent solution. Parents are leaving the workforce due to the lack of childcare at a faster rate than employers had anticipated. A full 1 in 10 of working parents have already turned down a new job or a promotion due to the lack of childcare. And half of all parents who have left the workforce since the start of COVID-19 cited childcare as the reason for that decision. I also wanted to share a little bit of data on women specifically, as much as I try really not to talk about childcare as a women's issue, because it's really an all of us issue. The disproportionate burden of the pandemic and care responsibilities on women is troubling, and our data corroborate what census data has shown. In June, close to 1 in 4 parents were unsure whether they would return to work. By October, that number had dropped to 13%. However, it was significantly higher for women than men, 17% of women unsure compared to 6% of men. The primary reason given for not returning, childcare concerns. And even for women who do plan to return to work, their return is happening at a much slower rate than men. By October, over 3/4 of men had already returned to work compared to half of women. So who are the childcare providers lending this critical support to working parents? The majority of childcare programs across the country are small business. 94% of providers are women, 15% of those are Black-owned small businesses. Many have experienced numerous temporary closures over the past year due to health and safety concerns for children and staff. Each closure, whether 72 hours or 2 weeks, has financial implications for those programs that are playing a vital role in the communities they serve. For the childcare programs that are still in business after such a difficult year, they now have increased operational costs to keep kids and staff safe, but greatly reduced revenue in order to follow public health guidelines. It's pretty clear our current situation isn't working. For parents, they're trying to balance childcare and work. For childcare providers, they're trying to stay open or reopen with an increasingly unsustainable new business model. And employers are trying to determine how and when their working parents can return. Childcare really is foundational to our economy because we cannot have a stable workforce without it. And it's clear that if we don't find long-term cross-sector solutions to this crisis, the negative impact on our workforce and economy will be felt for years to come. Thank you. Thanks so much for letting me be here with you today.
Thank you, Cheryl. Thank you for sharing what we know are really stark consequences if we don't step up and do it. And frankly, we really appreciate the chamber's role in this, because we know, as you said, this isn't just an education issue. This isn't just a women's issue. This is everybody. And if we want to get our economy reopened, if we want to be able to rebound in the way that we know we can, we've got to make sure that this community is supported. So now I want to turn it over to, we're going to hear directly from the folks on the ground, from our providers, both at the centers and family providers, as well as a parent. So I want to turn it over to Dr. Lisa Herbst, who owns two early childhood centers in Anne Arundel County. She's been in the business for over 30 years with toddlers and school-aged children, and her centers are both level 5 rated in Maryland Excel. So Dr. Herbst, we're really glad you're here, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much. I want to first say thank you to Delegate Solomon and Senator King for recognizing the chasm that those of us in the field feel like we're in. It feels like we've been forgotten between the priorities of public school and other small businesses. So we really, really thank you for bringing about this child care provider support grant possibility for us. My centers are struggling to stay open. It's been an almost 11-month struggle. We lost 90% of our enrollment from March to June of last year. In the summer, we climbed back to 40%. Since the fall and through the winter, we've been hovering between 50 and 60%. When I talk to my accountant, he says, "Lisa, it's not sustainable." We're carrying forward a $310,000 loss from 2020. And at some point, the burden will become too great for a small business like ours to continue. Some of my colleagues have already closed. We're hoping not to. And the grant would really make a big difference and allow us to remain viable perhaps a little bit longer until things turn around.
Thank you, Dr. Herbst. We really appreciate your being here, and thank you for all your effort. And now I want to turn it over to Carolina Reyes, who is a mother, an immigrant, and the owner and director of Arco Iris Bilingual Center, which is located in Laurel in Prince George's County. And Carolina, thank you for being here and for your advocacy.
Well, thank you. Thank you for inviting me. So I will start, and I wrote something because I get nervous sometimes, so I don't want to forget all the things that I have to say today. So thank you, Delegate Solomon and the committee, for being here, for my childcare providers, my teachers and families who are here today. During my 22 years working in early childhood education, I have noticed that American society often sees childcare as the place where children are cared for in generic fashion as simple babysitters, but not as a place where children are prepared socially, emotionally, and developmentally able members of society. My colleagues, who have been working hard for the last year to provide quality centers, know how difficult it is to run a childcare center. For almost a year now, childcare has been hit the hardest, with almost no recognition from our executive leaders in government. These make us feel invisible. Moreover, the small amount of financial assistance during the pandemic has made our economic viability even more precarious. Since I opened last August, my enrollment right now is only at 32%. I only have 19 children of 57 that I can have. Every month, the rent accumulates since I'm not able to pay the whole amount. Two of my four classrooms are closed temporarily right now. I have converted two classrooms, one of the classrooms for school agers to help my families, my teachers' children, and my own children with distant learning. As a small business owner, I have implemented policies to maintain the viability of my center, such as, you know, charging tuition while we were closed. Nevertheless, when we do close, I can see that many of my families working daily wages cannot afford to pay. For how much longer can we do this? I don't think that much. Just recently, two of my families, you know, didn't return because I had to close the center for 2 weeks due to a positive case in my center. Teachers left after COVID-19 arrived. Prior to COVID, I have 9 teachers. Right now, I only have 3. But the beauty to understand each other's struggles make the world a better place, right? That's what we hear. So thank you for this bill. Childcare is essential and necessary for our economy and support of our families. But most importantly, because we are preparing our children with a strong social, emotional, and developmental foundations to enter kindergarten. So please pass this bill to support childcare, but with a little bit of amendments, include all childcare, even though if they don't belong to Excels at this particular time of, you know, difficulties, we must include all of us. So I understand that sometimes we have to put certain rules, but I think it's important that we include everyone, even those who are not in Excel. So thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to be here, and I hope you can support this bill.
Thank you, Carolina, and you make a good point. We're this is a living, breathing document, and as many of you who have been in Annapolis know, oftentimes, especially this year where things are a little different, the emphasis on just getting something in is really important, and we wanted a bill to be on the books, at least to have folks to rally around. So just because you see it printed one way on the website does not mean that is the way it will look when hopefully it gets passed into law or gets incorporated into a larger package. So I know there have been some questions and concerns that have popped up. We're already working on some amendments, so we know. The important thing is that the folks hear your voice. We'll figure out the details and dot the I's and cross the T's, but what we really need is a commitment from our colleagues, that money needs to be there. So Carolina, thank you. And I'm gonna turn it over now to a couple of our family providers. So I'm gonna start with Christina Gagnon, who is a licensed provider, has been working for over 21 years and is currently the president of the Calvert County Family Daycare Association. Christina, I'll turn it over to you. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you for having me, Delegate Solomon. I just want to say that family childcare is very unique. We provide early childhood learning experiences and services in our home. I've been in business for over 21 years, and this is the first time in my business have I ever had to struggle to remain open. The additional costs that we have incurred since COVID has been outrageous. The additional costs are for cleaning supplies, our PPE items, the increase for food, and now internet for those of us who have the virtual learners. Our county had over 120 plus licensed family homes prior to COVID. We are down to 78 programs. That's it. More are closing. They're going to continue to close, and we do not have enough family providers or centers to give parents the care that they need in our community. So sadly, we have parents who are looking to unregistered people. This, of course, is a concern for us because we do everything in our power to make sure that the children get the care that they need and deserve in a safe and healthy environment. I want to thank everybody for their support in this rally, and I really hope that you guys do pass this bill. Child care providers around, we really need this help to keep us going. Thank you.
Thank you, Christina. Thank you for sharing the stark words. And now I want to turn it over to Kristen Selig, who is the owner and director of Creative Kids Learning Center, which is a large family daycare in Prince Frederick, Maryland. And Kristen has been in operation since 2003. Kristen, thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me. First, I would like to say that I've been in operation, like you said, since 2003. And this is the first time that I've had to close my business for any extended period. I closed back in March due to the fact that the majority of my families were given the opportunity to telework and that they decided to keep their children home, feeling that they were safer there with less exposure. Since then, I have been struggling the last few months and have resorted to relying on my parents for help financially. I have applied for grants and loans and basically any type of financial help I could find. In many of the cases, I was denied, being such a small business, or that the fact that I was a home daycare. In order to reopen my doors, which I'm presently trying to do, I've had to purchase numerous items, extra supplies. I've had to purchase daycare insurance. And all of this is extremely difficult when I have no financial income coming into the business. Any financial funding that would be eligible to childcare providers would be greatly appreciated. We are all struggling due to COVID. Creative Kids would greatly benefit as we would be able to reopen and provide care to the children of Southern Maryland. I would just like to thank you guys for trying to help us, and I would extremely benefit from the bill being passed.
Thank you, Kristen, and thank you for your work. We'll do what we can to make sure that you can stay in business. I know Senator King needs to run. We all have a lot of legislative commitments, but I did just want to give her one opportunity to say some closing remarks before she has to depart.
Thank you, Jared. I just, as I'm sitting here listening, you know, we've been talking for months about recovery and what we need to do, and there are just so many different parts, and all of this is so new to us that, you know, I'm sure we're going to make some mistakes along the way. None of it's perfect, but we're really going to work hard to try and get things back to normal as soon as we can. But this is something that I don't think a lot of people are really focused in on and aware of. And the more you can do to talk to your legislators, to let them know that this is a priority. If we want to get small businesses back to work, we want to get people back making their living at a business, we have to take care of people's kids or they won't be able to do it. So if you've got a chance to talk to your legislators, your delegates or your senators, and we've got to make people understand that this is really a huge issue as far as getting people back to work. So thank you all for taking the time to come and do this today. We need you to keep speaking up. So thank you.
Senator King, and that's actually a really great point that I wanted to touch on. So you'll see the folks from our team have been dropping every so often the link into the chat, which will take you to a wonderful page. We appreciate the Maryland Family Network for hosting it, that will allow you to send a personalized email to all of your legislators, your delegates and your senator. There's a form email in there that just gets you started, but you can go in and personalize it. The first step is going to be you can put in your address, and then it'll take you to who your individual legislators are. You don't have to use that if you if you want to email or call them directly. That's another great tool. But that email platform, that webpage, will tell you who they are, give you their phone numbers and all their contact information. And after we hear from our next speaker, we're actually going to pause for a couple of minutes and let you all do that. And I know, again, there have been some other comments in the chat. The original draft of the bill was meant to include both family child care providers and center providers. I know that was a big concern. That was a drafting error, so do not worry. And we're working on, you know, some of the other prioritization issues that have been raised. Again, as Senator King mentioned, this is a work in progress. You know, just because you see it here doesn't mean that that's how the bill is going to look at the end, or we're certainly, you know, we're hoping, you know, the bill process takes a little bit longer. What we're really hoping for is that this relief package that both the House and the Senate are working on that will provide immediate aid, that we can include something like this in that package, so that we don't need a separate piece of legislation, that we're just able to get the money out the door as quickly as we can. So what I gotta add
one more thing now that you said that.
Yeah, go ahead.
I always say that you take a bill and making legislation is like making sausage. It's not a real pretty process, but we come out with some pretty good stuff at the end, so just bear with us. But one thing I wanna say, if you can personalize whatever you send to your legislators, it has a much better chance of getting read. But if you just send a form letter and email it, it's almost wasting your time because we get thousands of them. So, but a personal note will have a much better chance of being read. So thank you all.
Thank you, Senator King. So now I want to turn it over to Julio Silva, who is a parent from Laurel, who works actually at an integrated community service, which is a healthcare provider. So Julio has been on the front lines as an essential worker. Thank you, since the beginning of this. And he actually has two children that attend Carolina's center, the Arco Iris Bilingual Center. So Julio, I'm going to turn it over to you for a little bit of the parent perspective, and thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me. My name is Julio Silva. I'm divorced and I share custody with two kids with my ex-wife. They are both going to Arco Iris Children's Center. We don't have any family here, so it was tough to find a childcare that can keep our children safe and healthy. Our children are the most important things in our life, and find a place that we can trust gave us the power to perform our jobs in peace. Last year, when the childcare facilities were shut down because of pandemic, work parents and facilities struggled for over months. And we are still struggling to perform our jobs. We have to use our PTO at jobs to be able to take care of them. I almost lost my job, and I'm sure without childcare, I can provide security to them. Childcare should definitely be considered essential, financial support, and the most important, recognized for, because it is critically important factor in our ability to earn a living for our families. The economic reality is that most families today consists of working parents like me, trying to juggle work schedule with caring for their children. I definitely believe that childcare is the base of the economy of this country. Thank you so much for having me.
Julio, thank you so much. Thanks for providing that perspective, and thank you for the work that you're doing on a daily basis to keep all of us safe. So at this point, what I wanted to do is just kind of pause for a couple of minutes. So as I mentioned, and Senator King mentioned, there is a link that's been entered into the chat, and I'll ask our team to just put it in there again. And I think for those of you who registered through our link, you should have gotten it as well. This is great. I mean, honestly, I will tell you, I don't think I've been on a Zoom since all of this started with this number of people. We've had through the course of the last half an hour or so, over 300 people, which is incredible. I think we may break my Zoom account, which is great. But, you know, it's wonderful to have everybody together with us today. But my colleagues in the House and the Senate and our leadership need to hear your voices. And they're going to hear that. Unfortunately, we can't storm the halls. We can't storm Lawyers Mall, you know, and rally and cheer. But what you can do is you can email and you can call. And so, you know, I want you to take the next couple of minutes. It shouldn't take long. You know, click through that link, find who your legislators are in the House and the Senate, and make sure that they hear what you're dealing with. They hear your voice. They know, you know, the struggles that you're going through, the you know, the work that you're doing to keep our families and our kids safe. So I want to pause for a minute. I'm going to play some music that's probably very familiar. It's one of my son's favorites. While we let folks click through that link and send letters. As you're sending them, why don't you put in the chat who you've emailed or called. Baby, you got baby. So what a fun.
See the water squirting out of your spout. Baby beluga, oh baby beluga, sing your little song, sing for all your friends, we like to
I love seeing these all of these notes come in of who you've emailed. And again, you know, just to let folks know, you know, the legislation's a work in progress. The most important thing is that our colleagues hear from you that this is a priority. We promise you, you're well represented in Annapolis with the organizations that are working on your behalf. We will figure out the nuts and bolts. When we're all finished here, but the most important thing for getting this up the list is that they hear from you. So the last thing that I would like to do, of everybody's time, is I know that some folks have made some really great signs, and so I wanted to see if you've been off camera. Maybe you could turn your cameras on and hold up your sign. And what we're going to try to do is pin all of the really good ones that we see, because we'd love the visual. Obviously, if we were together in person, we would have a big group of people with a lot of signs, but we're going to try and do a free screen of all of the great signs here. So if you've got them, hold them up. We'll see if we can make this happen. I know we're all juggling a lot, so some of them. See some other good ones. All right, well, last but not least, again, please share this link, share the advocacy information with your colleagues, with your families, who you're working with friends and neighbors, folks you know who may have kids and care about this. Now is the time. We are literally, so our bill is gonna be heard before the Ways and Means and Appropriations Committee tomorrow. Later this afternoon, the House will be taking up the Governor's Relief Act package. That recently is moving through the Senate. So now is the time. We scheduled this rally at the perfect sort of intersection of this bill and the relief package and the state budget. And so the next week or so is really going to be critical as all of the negotiations come to a head. So please keep in touch with us. We'll keep in touch with you. Please keep up the pressure on your legislators. And again, thank you from the bottom of my heart as the father of an 8.5-month-old and a former teacher myself. Thank you for all you're doing. I know there were comments in there about the vaccines. We are working tirelessly with the State Department of Health and with MSCE to improve that rollout as well. That has not been forgotten, and you have not been forgotten. So thank you for being here. Thank you again to all of our partners. Let's get this done. Take care, everybody.
Thank you, Delegate Solomon.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Delegate Solomon.
Thank you.
And all the speakers.
That was terrific. Thank you very much.
This is awesome. Oh my
Let's
God.
Let's keep advocating. Let's thank work together. Don't give up. You. Let's work.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Keep going.
Awesome.
You got your work cut out. Hang in there. Stay safe.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
$1,000 hero bonus for all childcare.
Thank you so much.
I'm sitting in the dark because the one child I have is napping. I am supposed to be having 8 children. They all left me when we closed.
Thank you.
But God is providing for me, and God is bringing me more children.
This is awesome.
Thank you. Please help us. We need the money.
Please help us. We need the money. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, this was a meeting intro.
This was awesome.
No. Gracias a las maestras latinas y a los proveedores latinos también. Gracias por todos. Seguir trabajando juntos.
Don't sleep, McCoy. I'm gonna get you. Let me take your blanket, put it on the table. Damn, boy. If I get
gracias a todas. Everything is going to work out well for all of us.
Yes, it is. Everything.
Thank you. Gracias.
All of
thank you for being present. Latino Choker Association is present.
Yes. Who's thank the legislator for Baltimore, Maryland? Anybody know?
What is that?
Who is the legislator? Legislation. I can't get it out.
Legislature.
If you look in the chat, there is a link that you can that will lead you to who your delegates and senator is.
I know COVID has made us to learn about the government, how it works, who is there, who is not there. COVID has a great deal, but also
I'm trying to find a link, but I couldn't find out who was for who's for Baltimore, Maryland.
Just Google. Who is my senator?
I will.
Put your address. Thank you. Put your address and you will should get down. Thank you, everybody. I'm hungry.
Okay. but ladies, I think we need
to talk about five star after.
I think we need send to the our representative because my concern how my childcare provider is the we don't have yet the vaccine. So we are very, very important for us because we are in contact with the parents. The teacher, I know they are very important. The majority, then there are classes, they are doing classes by Zoom, but ours, often have contact with the parents and the kids. So I think we need more priority. We need push for that. Please, we need it together.
Amen. I totally agree.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Goodbye, everyone. I have to shut it down. Thank you all very much for your support.
Thank you.
Contact your legislators.
Okay. Is it what is it saying on his thing?